Good evening, everyone, and a warm welcome to the 9th Maundalika Banerjee Memorial Lecture organized by the Department of English and the Alumni Association of Lady Brabourne College. These unusual times have compelled this endowment lecture to be pushed back from 2020 to March 2021, and also to organize it on this virtual platform. Maundalika Banerjee was a student of English Honours in this college from 1960 to 1963. Unfortunately, she passed away in 1986, succumbing to cancer. As desired by her family, this endowment lecture is being organized annually since 2012. Moreover, the Maundalika Banerjee Memorial Silver Medal is awarded to the best student of the English department, endowed by Sri Shomir Banerjee through the Alumni Association of this college. Today, we are indeed delighted to have amidst us distinguished scholar and academician, Professor Somdotta Mondol, former professor of English, Vishwabharati, who will speak on texts and contexts of diasporic Indian writing in English. It's a pleasure to have you amongst us, Professor Mondol. Thank you so much for being here with us today. May I now request our principal, Madam Professor Shivali Sarkar, to deliver her welcome address.
Thank you, Parna. Respected our speaker, Professor Somdotta Mondol, former professor of English, Vishwabharati University, our eminent guests and dignitaries, respected President and members of the Alumni Association, Lady Brabourne College, respected Malavi Kadi, our alumnus late Maundalika Banerjee's younger sister, respected Professor Somjukta Das, head of the department of the postgraduate department of English, Lady Brabourne College, my esteemed colleagues and our beloved students. It's a wonderful occasion when the Postgraduate Department of English and the Alumni Association of Lady Brabourne College have jointly organized the 9th Maundalika Banerjee Memorial Lecture. And the lecture is being started now. The topic seems quite interesting: texts and contexts of diasporic Indian writing in English. Diaspora refers to the dispersion of a people from their homeland. By diaspora literature is meant the works that are written by authors living outside their native land. Diaspora literature may also be identified by its contents, irrespective of where it has been written. Diaspora in Indian English literature is not new. Since our independence in 1947, diaspora writers have set a somewhat trend. Irrespective of language, style, literary form, and technique, diaspora literary pieces attract the readers crossing the borders. Focus maybe on the stream of consciousness or the problems of immigrancy or sense of alienation of the settlers or power of adaptation, tremendous power of adaptation, I should say, on the part of the settlers in a new geographical land and culture. It appears that for all diaspora writers, the English literature of the Indian diaspora involves a sense of nostalgia in common. We are all eagerly waiting to hear from our speaker today. And I'm pretty certain that a number of questions will be raised from the members of the audience. And after this lecture is over, everybody will try to think in a new way. Everybody will feel more and more enriched and more enlightened. I wish today's program a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Principal. And may I now request Dr. Malavika Bhattacharya, sister of the late Mandalika Banerjee, to please say a few words. Madam.
Good evening. I am Malavika Bhattacharya, professor of Spanish language and literature. And you must be wondering, what am I doing here, a Spanish professor among scholars of English? As you've just heard, I am Mandalika's younger sister, and I am here representing the family, that is to say, her husband, my brother-in-law, Shamir Banerjee, and Mandalika's son, Dr. Rajat Banerjee, who is an eminent oncologist in USA, and her daughter-in-law, Rachna, who is also a doctor, a virologist. As they live in USA, it is my duty, my pleasant duty, to express the gratitude of the family to Lady Brabourne College, the principal, Dr. Sholi Chakraborty, the English department, and the Alumni Association for organizing this memorial lecture as a tribute to the memory of my sister Mandalika, and that too in spite of the corona pandemic. I'm delighted that today's lecture will be delivered by Professor Somdatta Mondol, former professor of English at Vishwabharati. This means a lot to me because my husband, Professor Sabyasachi Bhattacharya, was the vice chancellor of Vishwabharati from 1991 to 1995. Talking about Mandalika, I think she inherited from our father, Hariprasad Chatterjee, his academic brilliance and the courage and confidence of our mother, Basundika, who herself was a gold medalist. Well, let's travel back in time to the year 1960. The young Mandalika had just passed out from the convent to Jesus Mary School in Delhi, having scored very high marks in senior Cambridge. And her parents brought her to Kolkata, where she joined the English honors course in Lady Brabourne College. Here, her teachers like Joshodhara Bagchi Sengupto and Shona Murshid instilled in her an abiding interest in writing. And very soon, Mandalika's articles were being published in popular and famous journals and magazines like Femina and Eves Weekly. Mandalika was also a keen debater, winning many trophies for her college. After her graduation in 1963, she married Samir Banerjee, a young engineer from Durgapur, and very soon they moved to USA. In USA, Mandalika joined the Silver Bullet Company as editor, and there she had a meteoric rise. Very soon, she was the chief editor of publications. But fate struck a cruel blow, and in 1986, she succumbed to cancer. Shomir had always known how important Lady Brabourne College was to his wife. Therefore, after her death, he expressed his gratitude by gifting this endowment to the college. I conclude by praying that may Lady Brabourne College keep on producing many more brilliant stars like my sister, Mandalika Banerjee.
Thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya, for that very vivid picture of your sister that you have given us today. And may I now invite Professor Somdatta Mondol to speak. But before that, let me introduce her to our students and to our other participants today. Professor Somdatta Mondol is former professor of English and former chairperson at the Department of English, Bishwabharati Shantiniketan. She has received her graduate and postgraduate degrees from the University of Calcutta and her MPhil and PhD degrees from Jadavpur University. She has held several administrative posts and has lectured widely in national and international forums. A recipient of several prestigious international fellowships and awards from the Fulbright Foundation, Charles Wallace Trust, Rockefeller Foundation, Salzburg Fellow, Shastri Indo-Canadian Institute, and Sahitya Academy, her areas of interest are American literature, contemporary fiction, film and culture studies, diaspora studies, and translation. She is widely published, and the details of her publication and other information are available on her website. And may I now invite Professor Mondal to please deliver the 9th Mandalika Banerjee Memorial Lecture. Professor Mondal, it's over to you now. It's all yours, the platform.
Good evening. Before I officially begin my lecture, I want to thank the Lady Brabourne College Alumni Association, the principal, Madam Bhattacharya, and all the other people who are here present to ask me to deliver this talk. Now, before that, I want to just digress a little and tell you something else. In the year 1971, that is exactly 50 years ago, a young girl fresh out of school studying in Howrah managed to come and get admitted to the English honors course at Lady Brabourne College. Those were the days still of the unrest due to the Naxalite movement, and her parents were so scared, admitted her to the hostel of Lady Brabourne College. 1971 is 50 years ago, and you can well understand who that person is. I am extremely happy that I, Somdatta Mondal, then Somdatta Das, studied at Lady Brabourne College. So it gives me double pleasure, you know, to come and deliver this lecture to my former department where I studied, where I got admitted 50 years ago. And even before Shongjukta asked me to deliver this lecture, our hostel friends, whom we have developed a much closer relationship even than our own English honors students, have already had, you know, through WhatsApp and other groups, have already gathered, have made several meetings, and for the pandemic, we couldn't do much. But in spite of that, a lot of us have got connected, and that connection remains till date. So you can understand, this evening's lecture is not just an ordinary, you know, endowment lecture for me. It has a lot of memories and pleasant associations for my own college, which I am quite surprised to think I got admitted half a century ago, exactly 50 years now. Now, with those words, at that point of time, when we got admitted in 71, the principal was Professor Shujata Chowdhury. And after a year, she retired. And the remaining 2 years, our principal was Professor Gauri Nag. And the year we left Lady Brabourne College, our very favorite teacher, Shanta Mohalanobish, she also left the college to go and join Bethune. So there are some associations that still are coming to my mind. I'm becoming a bit nostalgic, but it is really, you can understand, a very pleasant occasion, because since then I've never ever attended any alumni association meetings or even visited the college or hostel premises in all these years. Now, with these few words, thank you once again for inviting me. And as already declared, the title of my present talk is Texts and Contexts of Diasporic Indian Writing in English. As Madam Principal has already mentioned, but I repeat once again, the term diaspora
originated from the Greeks, meaning dispersal or distribution or spreading, that has been applied for many years to the worldwide scattering of the Jews. In more recent times, especially after post-colonial studies gained momentum, this term was applied to a number of ethnic and racial groups living distant from their traditional homelands. So when we speak of the Indian diaspora, writers generally refer to persons of Indian birth or ethnicity living abroad. In earlier times, often as a result of induced emigration or indenture, or later, usually by free election and often for economic, artistic, or social advantages. Emmanuel S. Nelson defines the Indian diaspora as the historical and contemporary presence of people of Indian subcontinental region in other areas of the world. Many of them are first generation expatriates who continue to consider India their true home, the place of their nurture, values, and extended families, as well as their deepest sympathies and attachments. However, this is not universally the case. Accommodated to overseas lifestyles, many members of the diaspora experience a distinct dissonance when reintroduced to their former subcontinental culture. G.S. Sharat Chandra, an author, in a book novel called Sari of the Gods, published in 1998, states, I quote, "I was 27 when I left India for good. Since then, I've steered a new course in my life. Though India is always on my mind, there is no link that connects the sudden stop my life came to there and my new self. I leaped from one life to another, and in between, I left nothing but a vacuum. Only imagination and memory, when I need them, act as my bridges. Thus, whenever I go back to India, I'm a stranger wandering almost invisibly in familiar neighborhoods," unquote. The literature of the Indian diaspora, therefore, is that body of writing in English produced by persons who identify themselves as of Indian heritage, who are living or have lived for some time outside the nation state of India or Mother India, in such places as Australia, Fiji, Trinidad, Guyana, Mauritius, Malaysia, East Africa, or in the Western countries such as Canada, the United States, Great Britain, and so on. Though the writing of the diasporic Indians is not new, it has of late raised complicated issues, which is the inward or talking point in post-colonial cultural and literary discourses. The formation of the Indian diaspora is one of the most significant demographic dislocations of modern times and can be classified, according to Sudesh Mishra, as the sugar and the masala diaspora. There is a distinction to be made between the old and the new diasporas. The distinction in between is, on the one hand, the semi-voluntary flight of indentured peasants to the non-metropolitan plantation colonies such as Fiji, Trinidad, Mauritius, South Africa, Malaysia, Suriname, and Guyana, roughly between the years 1830 and 1917. And on the other hand, the late capital or postmodern dispersal of new migrants of all classes to the thriving metropolitan centers such as Australia, the United States, Canada, and Britain. This same classification that Sudesh Mishra does, calling it the sugar versus the masala diaspora, is termed by other critics as forced diaspora and voluntary diaspora. Vinay Lal calls it diaspora of labor versus diaspora of longing. For most of the old diasporic writers, there is an unease of the dislocated and the deracinated who either from choice or from compulsion have abandoned their home in the country of their birth for housing in their adopted country. For instance, V.S. Naipaul, originally a third generation immigrant from a branch of Dubes of a Brahmin village of Uttar Pradesh, who moved to Trinidad, expresses a sense of unease on the question of inheritance. The first, second, third generation writers who were migrants from compulsion were usually descendants of indentured laborers from India sent to work in the various British colonial plantations, and they were known by the term the Girmitias. For the migrants of choice, the situation is totally different. Usually upper middle class and cosmopolitan, these first and second generation writers live in a kind of cosmopolitan globalized world where the marker of their borderless state have often to be invented. Apart from the fictional example of Thamma, who is confused between going and coming home in Dhaka, in Amitabh Ghosh's The Shadow Lines, I am also reminded of an experience in a particular international flight a few years ago when the plane was flying at about 30,000 feet height and the screen in front of me had the image of the plane with an arrow over it that was constantly pointing towards Mecca with the mileage noted in bold below it. This attempt at mooring oneself within the concept of a meta home in a borderless state of existence is, I think, another important feature of contemporary diasporic writing. Trying to find one's roots and then get rooted thus becomes a significant aspect of Indian diasporic writing. Academically speaking, the diasporic nature of Indian writing in English by the so-called voluntary diasporics once again have three visible sections. First, in the first category falls a writer like Bharati Mukherjee, one who detested the idea of being called the immigrant writer and considered herself to be mainstream American. Simplistically, she saw expatriates resisting assimilation, immigrants welcoming it. For me, she said, it is a movement away from the aloofness of expatriation to the exuberance of immigration, unquote. In the second category falls a whole group of writers who shuttle between different continents. Within this group, some write about their immigrant experiences, while others physically living there write on the exoticism of their home country or of characters who go as aliens and try to fit into the Western world. Sunetra Gupta is a case in point. Born in Calcutta, she now lives in Oxford, and her novels, Memories of Rain and A Sin of Color, are both set in Calcutta and Oxford. Living in London, Meera Sayal believes that duality and conflict makes you want to express yourself. That is why our generation is so outspoken. This is Meera Sayal. But the most complicated case of diasporic Indian writers is of the third category, whose origin is India, but whose work have no connections as such with the mother country. Bidisha Bandyopadhyay, who incidentally never writes her surname, she just writes Bidisha, is a second generation Bengali born and brought up in England. Her debut novel, Sea Horses, published in 1997, is an urban pageant about three young British men and is in no way even remotely connected to India. Another interesting example is that of Ava Daveswar, whose debut novel, The Three of Us, published in 2003, is not what we usually expect from a 26-year-old immigrant South Asian woman writer. She, living in New York, she creates a story that shrewdly explores sexual dependency from the perspective of a white male investment banker in Manhattan, New York, whose affairs range from having sex with his boss as well as his wife, all neatly timed with the help of a mini planner. In a recent article entitled India Away From Home, Daveswar explains her predicament and raises several pertinent questions that can be applied to many other diasporic writers as well. And I quote Daveswar, "My novel was about and in the voice of a young man, Andre Bernard, a white man, a gay man, an American. The book was not of India in any sense of the term. Can I be considered an Indian writer by virtue of my birth alone? Do I remain an Indian writer if I write in the voice of a white American man? Is my literature that makes me Indian or my passport?" This class of questions will gain in significance as diasporic writing speaks in more and more tongues. Let us also examine the case of Jhumpa Lahiri, whose Interpreter of Maladies took the literary world by storms. And if you remember, let me digress. When Jhumpa won the prize, Pulitzer Prize, she was hailed even in Bengali Kolkata newspapers, Amader Me. So we claimed her as ours in no time. And similarly, when she came all the way to get married with her Greek boyfriend in Kolkata in the typical Bengali fashion, and no reporters were allowed to report it, newspapers were covered, you know, pages after pages with all kinds of concocted news telling us how Amader Me was getting married in the Bengali tradition. Why I mention this is because when she came into limelight, the New Yorker, Bill Buford, the literary editor of the New Yorker, catapulted her into limelight when he first included her in the list of 20 best young fiction writers in America today. So she was an American writer for the Americans, but we claimed her as ours. Born in London, raised in Rhode Island, Connecticut, living for a few years in New York, and presently settled in Rome, in Italy, Jhumpa set some of her stories in Calcutta, because what she called of a necessary combination of distance and intimacy. And in an interview said, I quote, "I went to Calcutta neither as a tourist nor was a former resident, a valuable position, I think, for a writer. I learned to observe things as an outsider, and yet I also knew that as different as Calcutta is from Rhode Island, I belonged there in some fundamental way, in the ways I didn't seem to belong to the US," unquote. Kiran Desai, whose debut novel, Hullabaloo in the Guava Orchard, found extraordinary welcome on both sides of the Atlantic, shuttles between New York and Cambridge, and even goes off to a remote retreat along with her mother, Anita Desai, for literary inspiration. The way all these novelists' names are now used at random by critics to define Indian writing in English as well makes things complicated indeed. Also, the question remains whether writers living outside India forfeit the right to comment on behalf of an entire nation or not. Living in diaspora means living in forced or voluntary exile. And living in exile usually leads to severe identity confusion and problems of identification with and alienation from old and new cultures and homelands. In the novel Shame, Salman Rushdie generalizes, I quote, "All migrants leave their pasts behind, although some try to pack it into bundles and boxes. But on the journey, something seeps out of the treasured mementos and old photographs until even their owners fail to recognize them. Because it is the fate of migrants to be stripped of history, to stand naked among the scorn of strangers upon whom they see the rich clothing, the brocades of continuity, and the eyebrows of belonging." So he is not very, you know, appreciative of the diasporic writer. Therefore, most diasporic writing is suffused with identification consciousness and the problems of living in an alien society. As Rushdie had put in Imaginary Homelands, the famous essay, the position of the exile or immigrant is one of what he calls profound uncertainties. The diasporic person is at home neither in the West nor in India and is thus unhomed, a phrase which Homi Bhabha uses in The Location of Culture, and in the most essential sense of the term, unhomed. Thus, the concept and interpretation of home, within quotes, becomes vital in all kinds of diasporic writing. According to Sudesh Mishra, the movement from Sri Prasad Naipaul to Meera Sayal suggests an important rethinking of the concept of home within the diaspora, especially as this occurs against the backdrop of the global shift from the centering or centripetal logic of monopoly capitalism to the decentering or centrifugal logic of transnational capitalism. Whereas for the sugar diaspora, home signifies an end to itinerant wandering, in putting down the roots, home for the masala diaspora is linked to the strategic espousal of rootlessness, to the constant mantling and dismantling of the self in makeshift landscapes. So, when diasporic writing tries to reflect real and imaginary worlds, it is, according to Salman Rushdie once again, obliged to deal in broken mirrors, some of whose fragments have been lost. Thus we find roving, unsettled, alienated people in the fictive world of contemporary diasporic writers, yearning for a real or imaginary homeland, a permanent or temporary return. The declared intention of inclusive cultural translation, of universalization, goes sadly awry in created aesthetic constructs. However, this could also be seen as the strength of diasporic texts, that they are incomplete, the fact that they do not claim to offer the ultimate truth, the fact that they deal with alternatives rather than essentials. It is these alternative histories and narratives that Rushdie's text has offered, right from Midnight's Children down to The Ground Beneath Her Feet. The different labels that have been attributed to Indian diasporic writing includes neither here nor there. Uma Parameswaran, the Indian diasporic writer settled in Canada, has described it as the Trishanku situation, borrowing from the mythic tale of the Ramayana of Trishanku, who is neither here nor there, suspended in animation in a mid-make-believe world. And these two metaphors are constantly used now by diasporic critics. Another phrase that is often used is the des-pardes syndrome. So the writers suffer from a kind of des-pardes syndrome. Further, diasporic writers have variously described themselves under different labels. They called themselves migrants, plural, hybrid, expatriate, immigrant. So every individual investing these words with personal and restrictive connotations. The alienated consciousness of the writer using the English language is another important factor. But since the late 1970s and early 1980s, after expatriation, immigration to the West, the trauma of uprooting, the diasporic consciousness and the loss of home and identity had preoccupied many Indian writers in English. In order to do away with the false image of projecting India as a land of snake charmers and princes and elephants, they started inscribing Indian words without glossary or italization into the text with a sort of vengeance, so to say. This has also brought in criticism about unnecessary exoticization of their novels. The relationship between East and West, both used as metaphors for different ways of life, have also been explored in the writings of most Indian diasporic writers. They have often been criticized of writing for the Western audience in mind and with an eye towards bagging a Booker or a Commonwealth Writers Award. Along with their astronomical advance amounts, they all seem to try out their luck in this Cinderella syndrome. As Bill Buford, the editor of New Yorker, says, I quote, "It shows publishers in the West that books by an Indian writer could sell. In understanding what motivates the makers of literature, as Dr. Johnson knew, It pays to think about pay. This is Bill Buford. Now, the diaspora has, Indian diaspora has perceptibly modified the four primary zones of contact that have provided a social framework for Indian English literary culture since the late 18th century. The principal changes being that the zones are now geographically located overseas. First, in its foreign setting, the zones now bring in Indian professionals into contact with people of many more races and nationalities than it did in the colonial period on the subcontinent, absorbing them into a radically multicultural and multilingual international white-collared workforce. It also attracts much higher number of educated Indian women into a wide array of professionals than before, especially in North America, which has contributed generally as well as concretely to the growth and dissemination of Indian women's writing and intellectual work across international borders. Coming to the present context, we are gradually noticing a shift in the themes of the novels by Indian diasporic writers. The earlier ideas of cross-cultural encounters between the home culture and the culture of the newly adapted nation of an individual, issues of acculturation and other things seems to be passé now. Every second day, we are coming across new diasporic writers, new kids on the block. Neil Mukherjee, who wrote a huge Living in England, the tome of a novel, The Life of Others, and it is about Kolkata. Akhil Sharma gained such great importance, and after a couple of novels, this is what I'm trying to say. You know, every time I visit the US, I find new Indian writers being written about, being praised in the diaspora. I buy the novels, read them, but after one or two novels, they disappear into oblivion. They are no longer this young breed seen. Same thing happened in one visit. I heard rave reviews about a young girl called Tishani Doshi and many more debut novelists, but soon they faded into oblivion after a book or two, after coming into the limelight and being praised by either the New York Times or the Guardian as a new emergent voice of the Indian diaspora. Very recently, there are some other problems of, I told you about Jhumpa Lahiri's case. Jhumpa Lahiri, we claim as Indian, there is question about her Indian identity because her parents migrated from India. She was born and brought up in the US, and the Pulitzer Prize that brought her fame is always given for American writers, not Indian, but we claimed as hers. That is not the point. Very recently, I came across another book of another new diasporic writer, which tells us how complicated the situation has turned. And her name is Avni Doshi. Avni Doshi, a novel was published in 2019, just year before last. It was called Girl in White Cotton. And why she came into limelight was because this novel was shortlisted for the Booker Prize in 2020. Avni Doshi was born in New Jersey. She lives in Dubai. She studied in the US and London. And her book is a journey into shifting memories, altering identities, and the subjective nature of truth. Tracing the fragile line between familial devotion and deception, this debut novel will surprise and unsettle readers. When I was trying to read up a little more about this author, Wikipedia defined her in one sentence as an American novelist. And this novel that was shortlisted for the Booker was basically about a very difficult mother-daughter relationship. So where does diasporic writing stand? As I mentioned, what Hawa Daveshwar questioned, that how do we label now in the 21st century a diasporic writer of Indian origin? If the label just goes on increasing. Now, so what happens? Citing and coming to more established writers of the Indian diaspora, the situation is quite interesting. As one notices a definite tectonic shift in the subject matter of the new books of these same writers. Jhumpa Lahiri's last few books have nothing to do with the diaspora. After settling down in Rome, she's writing about the use of language and even attempting to write in Italian. So the angst of Gogol Ganguly, in her famous novel, and all that no longer exists. So do we think that, have they passed what you call a kind of rite of passage to write about diasporic angst and now trying to settle elsewhere? This question has been worrying me for quite some long time, not only because of Jhumpa Lahiri. I will give you a couple of more examples. Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni has completely shifted to narrating women-centric stories based on Indian mythology. And after having protagonists like Draupadi, Sita, she has now shifted to narrating the last novel, the historical character of Rani Jindan Kaur, the last wife of the queen, the last queen of Punjab, and the wife of Raja Ranjit Singh, in her latest novel published a couple of months ago called The Last Queen. So the same Chitra Divakaruni, on whom so many scholars have written thesis, a couple of my own students did their PhD work on Bharati Mukherjee and Divakaruni's writings about cross-cultural and assimilation in the new world. But this is what she is now selling: Indian mythological characters to keep her fame alive. Sita, first it was Draupadi, the queen of dreams, and then it was the forest of enchantments, and now the third is the last queen. Nothing to do with diaspora at all. So can we still praise her as an Indian diasporic writer because she is living in Houston and teaching creative writing courses at the university there? Or should we call her a diasporic Indian writer based on all the earlier novels and short stories she wrote? This is a problem. Now, not only these two writers, let me now give you another example. Amitava Ghosh, who from his very first novel used transnational locations for his stories, did so very clearly even in his last novel, The Gun Island. And though deeply concerned about climatic changes and global warming, he still focused on the major issue of migration. In illegal migration, both legally and illegally. Interestingly, his latest book, if you are aware, which was published on the 12th of February last month, was Jungle Nama, and it was a graphic novel released to narrate the story of Bon Bibi in the Sundarbans. So this is a writer whom we label as a diasporic writer who lives 6 months in New York, 6 months in Goa, and you know, is representative of the famous names that we label as diasporic Indian writers. So from these examples, I think it becomes clear that it will no longer be possible to label diasporic Indian English writers under one umbrella, as with the passage of time, they move to newer pastures, continue to market and sell their new books as a worthwhile commercial product, so the base but day syndrome is totally forgotten. Finally, before I conclude, I just want to mention, I spoke about transnationalism and the new world order, globalization. Now post-colonial writers of diaspora are talking about globalized citizen, globalization. And I think, you know, the idea generated much more after the publication of Thomas Friedman's idea that the world is flat. In his book that analyzes globalization primarily in the early 21st century, the text, you all are aware, it's called The World is Flat, A Brief History of the 21st Century, published in 2005. The title, of course, is a metaphor for viewing the world as a level playing field in terms of commerce, wherein all competitors, except for labor, have an equal opportunity. So, in the global market history, and geographical divisions are becoming increasingly irrelevant, does diasporic Indian English writer remain the same? No, it is no longer the same as it was two or three decades ago, and we really don't know what is going to happen in the near future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Mondol, for that very, very interesting, illuminating and thought-provoking lecture. And may I now invite our head of the department, Professor Shongjukta Das, to please deliver the vote of thanks. It's over to you, Professor Das.
Thank you, Porna. First of all, I would like to thank our principal, Professor Shuli Sarkar, who, when barely in her second year as principal, she was the one who, under whose principalship this endowment lecture was instituted. So thank you, madam, for facilitating the institution of the Mondalika Banerjee Memorial Lecture. I thank Professor Shomdatta Mondol for her tremendous, thorough, wide-ranging introduction into diasporic writing. And like all your books and publications, Professor Mondol, you have given our students and all of us a very good view. And it's amazing how you keep up with this contemporary, absolutely up-to-date developments in the field. Thank you so much for that. The Lady Prebone College Alumni Association has nurtured the Mondalika Banerjee Endowment with great care. And I thank Ajunta Di, Changumitra Di, and particularly Mamata Di, because she has been liaising with us for this particular lecture. I thank you that you have bridged the difficulties of the pandemic and have still encouraged and been very patient with us, what with all our exams and all, that we organize this when we can. Thank you very much. I thank Malavika Di, sister of Mondalika Banerjee, for the way you have through the years nurtured this endowment and your personal palpable interest in this endowment. And our thanks also to the family of Mondalika Banerjee, her husband and her son. I thank my colleagues in the department who have facilitated this lecture and their hard work. And last of all, but not least of all, our special participants, our dear students who have also learned a lot from this lecture. Thank you all. Have a very good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Are there any questions? Chongjukta?
Actually, the thing is, in an endowment lecture,
normally you don't ask questions.
Normally we don't have questions. So we would be happy to, I was doing a bit of work on Meena Alexander and Sujata Bhatt, the poets. So if you could also speak of,
I deliberately did not bring in poets. Meena was a good friend of mine, personal friend, till she passed away. Whenever I went to New York, I would go budge into her department. And one very important topic that Meena constantly would mention was the phrase, which applies also to the fiction writers. She attempted a couple of fictions, which did not really sell that well. Her nonfiction and poetry is more important. But Meena coined a particular phrase, which she used, she called fault lines. You were standing amid the fault lines between two volcanic seismic. So all the diasporic writers, Meena had come for a visit to Shantiniketan. I had invited her.
Yes, I did that too.
Yes. In Shantiniketan to our department. And one thing she constantly says that, just as in California, people are constantly in this seismic shift zones. So this fault line is always there. The uncertainty of the immigrant is always there. And Meena, as you know, had multiple migrations from Africa to England, to Hyderabad, to India, and then back to New York. It's a pity that she passed away a couple of years back. But Meena's poems, and I think her theoretical position can be applied to diasporic writing in general, not only to poetry. This is one thing I have to say. And for Sujata Bhatt, that is another issue. Sujata Bhatt's case is, we have been constantly talking about writers either in the UK or in the US. Sujata Bhatt's case is someone settled in Germany, so the European context. But what is interesting with Sujata's poetry, the little I read, is how she mixes her Gujarati words, her Gujarati tongue, within her poetry to make this bilingual kind of existence, even living abroad in Germany. So, on the one hand, but what I am finding interesting, what I wanted to share with you people now, is even established writers, let alone the new ones, we cannot label them permanently as diasporics, as what they were earlier. In order to sell, in order to survive, well, novels need to be sold, writers need to get their money, and readers should be interested. But how longer can you go on talking about, when the playing field has been leveled a lot? We are now in the world of emails and WhatsApps and you know, that nostalgia, which was a big part, which played especially in the old diasporic writers, the Girmitias writers, the indentured people's writers, the Bidesia poems, they would long and hanker for that romantic myth of Rams. You know, they considered themselves to be similar to the position of Ram's exile, 14 years of exile, that after that period is over, they are going to come back once again to their motherland. And those nostalgic Bidesia songs, a lot of more research should be done on that. Most of them is not in English. It is still in Bhojpuri, because most of them wrote and composed in Bhojpuri. So these are areas, but this, what I repeat once again, you know, it's very difficult to label a writer as one particular diasporic writer because of this tectonic shift that is going along with time, especially in the 21st century. And writers are trying to find different other avenues and move away from what we typically thought was the root of home, homelessness, acculturation, immigration, problems, all that. I think that phase is gradually over and they are looking. Same thing I think will apply to the poetry as well, irrespective of where you are staying. I hope I explained.
Thank you very much, Chomdatta. Thank you very much for that. Porna?
Yes, it's okay. I don't know whether Chomdatta Di remembers me. We did a refresher together at Jadavpur University.
Yes, of course.
Okay. No, I'm not asking any questions. I just wanted to know whether she recalls how we enjoyed that refresher course, so to speak.
And what really is surprising, but thank you, Shongjukta, is that 50 years of association with Lady Brabourne College, how, you know, it is a kind of homecoming after all these years.
Actually, it is Porna who suggested your name. And I'm so glad that you immediately, you know, you kind of accepted our invitation.
It was very nice speaking to you. And as it is, as I told you in the beginning, we had already started, you know, our nostalgic trips of 71 to 74 days of living in Park Circus with our hostel friends, not so much our daily, you know, English department friends, but primarily hostel friends who of different disciplines, who we developed very close, you know, relationships. So we have already started capturing that. And we realize we've all grown old, and 50 years ago was quite a long time.
Madam, please once visit our college and hostel. Please.
Yes, I should. For us. I've never been there. There hasn't been any occasion for me to visit the college or the hostel once again.
Please, we are living
in that nostalgia.
Visit the college and the hostel. We will be delighted, ma'am.
Yes. Let the pandemic go away.
Sure, ma'am.
I will surely find. And now that I've retired last year, I have much more time to stay in Kolkata than Shantiniketan. So it will be easy for me to come and visit the college once again and meet all of you. Yes. Thank you so much.